So first, thank you everyone for coming. We're really thrilled about this debate. First, I should definitely thank Marissa and King and Spalding in general for hosting us here tonight. This is a really beautiful space. I've been told we can actually go out on the balcony there if we want after the round. So that's exciting, and it's also like a gorgeous view. Just really, really appreciative. I want to thank our judges and debaters. Basically, I'll just kind of give a brief kind of summary of One Day Sooner and Rikers Debate, the two groups kind of putting this on tonight, and then briefly tell you a bit about what the debate is going to look like. Then you're going to get, Jake is going to come up and just say a little bit of kind of background on the topic in general. Then we'll start the debate. During the debate, kind of in between the fourth and fifth speech, there'll be some time for the audience to kind of give what are called floor speeches. So those are speeches up to 2 minutes. Usually, if we can find someone, and hopefully we'll be able to, there'll be one speech in favor of banning gain of function, one against banning gain of function, and a crossbench speech that kind of makes points on both sides. So kind of look alive, take some notes, try to, audience participation is good. And then after the round, we're gonna have the judging panel is gonna go out and kind of confer and kind of discuss the round for about 20 minutes. And folks in the audience will also discuss. And we'll have, I have to figure out how the math will work, but basically people in the audience will also have a ballot, and the audience vote will be worth something like 1 to 3 votes. And each of the judges' vote gets a vote as well. But before going into any more of the debate details, I'm just to tell you briefly about the two organizations here, both of which I have the honor of being a part of. I guess I'll start with One Day Sooner and then talk about Rikers Debate. So One Day Sooner is a group that represents people who want to be in research studies, in particular challenge studies or controlled human infection studies. We started with people who were interested in COVID challenge studies, and we actually had more than, or almost 40,000 people in more than 160 countries sign up with us as being interested in being in a COVID challenge study and being actually infected with COVID deliberately in order to test vaccines and develop treatments. And really, it's a matter of wanting to do something kind of pro-social and kind of help the world in some way to kind of help medical research. And so now we've branched out beyond COVID to work in other diseases like hepatitis C or Zika, where challenge studies are useful. Just to give sort of almost a random example, there was recently a malaria vaccine. There's one that's being implemented right now in Africa that was developed with over a dozen challenge studies. And there's one that just had very promising results that also used challenge studies. So they're incredibly important scientific tools. We're also working now on advocacy campaign for an Operation Warp Speed 2.0 for next generation coronavirus vaccines, so intranasal vaccines or universal vaccines. We're doing a conference with a lot of people behind Warp Speed in November, so we're really excited about that. One challenge today, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention. Don Milton, who's one of our judges, you'll hear all the judges introduced, and we love all of our judges equally. But Don Milton is actually running a challenge study in early winter for flu, and it's a kind of special type of challenge study called a controlled natural exposure study, where what you're trying to do is to understand how flu is transmitted and how to stop it from being transmitted, how to stop other airborne diseases like COVID from being transmitted. And so there's kind of two things. One, if you'd like to be in a quarantine facility for 2 weeks and be deliberately infected with flu, then Don's your guy. But also, that one of the major difficulties in doing this type of study is finding cases of flu that happen naturally and bringing them in as quickly as possible to be in the study so that they can help transmit and make the study possible. And so if you or anyone you know gets flu in early 2023, think of Don Milton, think of you, Maryland, and try to contribute to science, because it really could be quite crucial and useful. You're welcome. See, you came here for a reason, to deliberately infect people in the audience. That's as much as I'll say about One Day Sooner. Rikers Debate, I'm the president of One Day Sooner. I run public events and one of the founders of the Rikers Debate Project. And the Rikers Debate Project teaches people who are incarcerated and formerly incarcerated debate. And so I think people, why debate over other things? And I think it's for a few reasons. One is that a lot of people, a lot of people you'll see tonight, did debate in college or high school. We have this connection to it. And you know, I got to judge debate at Rikers, and that's what kind of drew me into it, just seeing like the amazing perspective and talent that people at Rikers have just for this activity. So it's sort of selfish in that way. But also, it's something that allows you to see both sides of an issue, and I think it's a useful skill to help for public speaking and critical thinking. And we also think that it's really important that people who are incarcerated and formerly incarcerated have their political views, sort of heard in the public sphere. And that's, I think it's true, you know, not just on criminal justice reform issues, but on issues in general. So that's part of why we're interested in doing topics like this that aren't about criminal justice reform. And partly, you know, like the goal of debates like this, on each team tonight, you'll be one formerly incarcerated debater, one debater who was a debater in college, and then one person who's kind of a subject matter expert. And I think that it's useful to have these kind of different perspectives on an issue, and I think it really helps see kind of a diversity of ideas and sort of seeing how the same topic can look from a range of different perspectives. And that's why we try to encourage different parts, of having audience participation, having audience talk to each other, and judges talk to each other, is kind of getting out a range of ways of looking at this this topic. So the other debate logistics, the speeches will all be 3 minutes, and then there's a 1 minute grace period. As you can tell from me, debaters usually like to hear ourselves talk and don't like to shut up and sit down. So after that 1 minute, we'll start pounding on the floor or on the seats in order to shut people up. Participate in that. There's a recording going on. I don't know if we'll end up making it public, but if we do, anyone who's recorded, or anyone who speaks here, or like any judge or anything, will have the opportunity to redact any of the remarks they'd like before it goes public. I mentioned the audience getting to vote, so we'll hand out some pieces of paper for that. And then I think, unless I'm forgetting anything, one of the cool parts about our style is that the two teams don't know which side they're going to be on. They prepare both sides, and so we're going to flip a coin. Actually, somebody needs to give me a coin because I don't have a coin. We're going to flip a coin to decide which team is on which side. We're old-fashioned here. You know, we don't know the unrestrained benefits of technology. How about this side? Can pick which
heads. We'll call heads.
Heads, and the sitting is tails. Yeah, this is heads. Oh, sorry, this is tails. So this side gets to pick. Whose coin is this? So there'll be opposition arguing pro gain-of-function research against banning gain-of-function research, and this will be the government team arguing in favor of banning gain-of-function research. First, Jake will give a bit of background on the topic, and then we will do the actual debate.
Thank you, Josh. My name is Jake. I'm the communications director at One Day Sooner, also one of the debaters. First, I want to introduce our illustrious panel of judges here. Starting from the right, we have Camelia Finley, who's one of the Rikers Debate Fellows and a consultant at Community Family Life Services and a peer mediator for the National Reentry Network for Returning Citizens. We have Charles Hopkins, who is another Rikers Debate Fellow and the president of the Prince George County National Action Network. And then we have Professor Aaron Sorrell, who is the assistant professor of microbiology and immunology at Georgetown University and the director of the Elizabeth R. Griffin Program at the Center for Global Health and Science and Security. And she's previously worked as senior analyst at the Department of State's Biosecurity Engagement Program. You ready for me to just read off all of your LinkedIn's? We have Don Miller, Dr. Don Milton is professor of environmental health at University of Maryland School of Public Health, where he leads the Public Health, Air Biology, Virology, and Exhale Biomarker Laboratory, which studies airborne pathogen transmission. We have Jerusalem Demsis. Jerusalem is a staff writer for The Atlantic. I'm terrified of debating in front of her because she finished the 2017 APTA debate season as its top-ranked debater, according to a website that I read. We have the lovely Marissa Malik, who's our host here at King and Spalding. Marissa is a partner in the FDA and Life Sciences Practice and a former clerk for the Supreme Court of Justice Thomas. And then we have Victoria Howard, who's a manager at Schmidt Futures, where she focuses on works in support of technology and technology and policy initiatives before joining Schmidt. Victoria also worked as a tech congress fellow in the office of speaker Nancy Pelosi. We have then Christine Parthmore as the CEO of the Council of Strategic Risks, a think tank focused on major STEM risks in the 21st century. Previously served as a senior advisor to the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Nuclear, Chemical, and Biological Defense Programs at the Department of Defense, which is a lot of words. and then we have Professor Gigi Gronewall, and she is, among other things, an associate professor in the Department of Environmental Health and Engineering at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and immunologist with a deep background in biosecurity, including a recent book, or not so recent book, recent synthetic biology, safety and security, and promise. I said it because I'm the person here in the recent book. And then finally, we have Matt Walsh, who is a PhD student in health security at Johns Hopkins University and previously worked at MIT Lincoln Laboratory in synthetic biology experiments with national security and human health applications. So now we get to the fun part where, despite there being approximately half a dozen more people qualified to talk about this more than me, I'm going to explain briefly what gain-of-function research is for those of us. For instance, imagine you're a clumsy nonprofit director who's founded several nonprofits and did not do his homework and is asked, Jake, what is gain-of-function research? And I would say, that's a really good question. And the answer is, it's really, really complicated and no one seems to know for sure, like communism or love. The term kind of popped up in 2011, in the wake, 2011-2012, following a series of two experiments in the Netherlands, by one team in the Netherlands, then one team in Japan and Wisconsin, which are like right next to each other. Those were on H5N1, which is a very, very highly pathogenic strain of influenza. And the purpose of the research was to answer the question, like, what if it got bad for humans? Because H5N1 is traditionally, there is generally not very transmissible among humans. It's very transmissible among birds. And there was some thought among scientists that it would be unlikely to ever adopt to humans. So those researchers pretty convincingly demonstrated that, no, that's very wrong, and it is actually not particularly difficult to get H5N1 to pass through mammals, in this case ferrets, and become incredibly transmissible. And that's very interesting information, also kind of terrifying. If you, like me, spend way too much time on the internet, you might have heard, for instance, about the recent case of the TikTok famous emu, Emmanuel, who had H5N1, or supposedly had H5N1, and its owner stuck its face, her face against this emu because it was, she was very sad about losing it, and like that sort of thing, where H5N1 or another avian flu could be easily transmitted among humans, is an incredible public health concern, and especially if we're, again, making it in the context of making a more seriously transmissible virus. So a lot of the scientists argued that, a lot of scientists at the time argued, and researchers at the time argued that sort of research should not have been done. But supporters countered by saying, for instance, that knowing the genotype of the H5N1 virus that was even more transmissible was helpful for instance, surveillance. So public health network systems found that virus in the wild circulating in a city, it would give us advanced warning and enable us to initiate, for instance, lockdown measures that could prevent it from becoming a global pandemic. So back to the definition of gain-of-function research, it usually refers to the manipulation of a microorganism like a virus to confer a trait that it did not have before, and which usually makes it more of a concern in public health. But even with this, there's some controversy. Last week, the venerable Daily Mail reported on an experiment run at Boston University. Researchers grafted a spike protein from the Omicron variant of COVID onto the original SARS-CoV-2 variant from Wuhan, and the result was an even deadlier strain, more deadly than Omicron variant in mice, less deadly than the original Wuhan strain. There's been a lot of fighting over whether or not that was gain-of-function research specifically, whether or not the government needs to be notified. But it's an example of that kind of research that is actually pretty common, or not uncommon, I should say. And most countries have pretty minimal oversight of this type of research. So the United States, there was an attempt to put a moratorium on it. There was a moratorium on it from 2014 to 2017 for particular types of pathogens like influenza and coronavirus because of how dangerous those can be. That has since been replaced by the P3CO framework, which requires review by NIH before funding certain aspects of certain kind of high potential or high risk research. But a lot of countries just don't really do a lot of oversight of it to begin with. And that has a lot of people very worried. So it's in that context that we have this debate over whether or not gain-of-function research should be banned outright in the United States. The specific topic is whether or not should the United States government or the United States government from the government side, the United States government should ban gain-of-function research. And I'm hoping that you guys will enjoy it. And again, we'd love some audience participation. Thank you again for our judges for coming out for us. We'll give a round of applause for them. And with that, we will be good to go.
I call this house to order, and I call on the Honorable Prime Minister for the first conservative round now to exceed 3 minutes. You're here.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the government, members of the opposition. My name is Dominic Crispino. I speak on behalf of the government. We are seeking to ban gain-of-function research. The definition of gain-of-function in this context is research where a change is made or added in a pathogen that makes it more infectious or more transmissible. This is a recipe for disaster. As such, we must weigh its dangers against its benefits to see if gait of function is something we should engage in. It must be banned, and our reasons are twofold. First, the potential benefits from gain of function are actually speculative. It is effectively a spin of the roulette wheel where the odds of enhancing preparedness are actually very long. Second, the costs for gain of function research are potentially very high. When you weigh these costs against these benefits, it is clear that it should be banned. Our first point is that the benefits are low and speculative. There are a myriad of ways which viruses can mutate. Changing one variable or manipulating RNA to enhance the transmissibility or dangerousness of a virus is not the only way we can study viruses. We have biological methodologies, such as isolation, purification, characterization, studying structure and interactions in nature, as well as loss of function research. We can learn as much or more than gain of function research using these tried and true traditional methods. Just because the addition of a protein to a virus or manipulation of its RNA may possibly indicate how it mutates, there is no indication that this is the only way. There could be thousands of ways where it can mutate. Therefore, gain of function research is truly, if you look at it, a spin of the roulette wheel where the odds are too long that one would hit the exact number on the causation that would occur in nature. Balance that against the potential costs of gain of function research. There's been a history of lab problems. In 2014, the CDC mishandled the avian flu virus and had it contaminated by the HSN1 virus by influenza researchers. In that same year, the CDC was cleaning up and they found 6 vials unattended in a closet. 75 federal employees that same year were accidentally exposed to anthrax due to a laboratory mistake. This amply shows that laboratory shipping and custodial errors are out there and occur. Now, we have no indications this has occurred with gain-of-function research, but all it takes is one. Now, like I said, it's inherently a recipe for disaster. Look at Dr. Fourchier's ferret experiments reported in 2001 when the H5N1 avian flu was modified to acquire mutations adapted to human-to-human transition. A lab error in that situation would have been a disaster. Are we not opening Pandora's box here? Therefore, it is abundantly clear that the costs are too high and the benefits too speculative, given the dangerousness of the research. A spin of the function of the gain-of-function roulette wheel is not justified under these circumstances. It is a gamble we cannot afford in discharging our duty as a government to protect the public health. As such, we propose that gain-of-function research should be banned. Thank you.
Here.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good evening, all in attendance. My name is Shani Forrester. I'm the leader of the opposition. We oppose a blanket ban on gain-of-function research. The government's definition of gain-of-function research is too narrow. Gain-of-function research entails modifying genotypes of microorganisms to create traits they did not previously have. And this can include things like modifying adenoviruses using vaccines. We oppose a ban for 3 reasons. First, a ban would be overbroad. Even if we believe that some gain-of-function research should be banned, that does not mean all of it needs to be banned, because research can still be done in safe and controlled ways. For example, we still do nuclear energy research and maintain nuclear energy facilities, even though that sort of research could be misused as a cover for nuclear weapons programs, and even despite the risk of reactor meltdowns. And the importance of nuclear energy has been confirmed most recently by the surge in high oil and gas prices. As another example, the CDC conducts controlled research on smallpox. Even though that virus is highly deadly, the continued importance of such research is clear, because smallpox-related viruses like monkeypox can emerge, and even viruses we thought were vanquished, like polio, can reemerge. Second, gain-of-function research is critical for scientific advancement. If we study diseases in a controlled setting, we need animal models. And that often means we need to pass pathogens through generations of animals until they can better infect them. Many medical advances have been based on gain-of-function research. Adenoviruses are modified to deliver vaccines. Venetoclax is a leukemia drug developed based on gain-of-function research. It targets BCL2, a gene that was discovered to create tumor-promoting protein. Even though this research didn't involve making virus or bacteria more dangerous, it is still gain-of-function research, and the overbroadness of the government's plan could mean that important research like this is slowed down for fear of breaking the law. It could also push research overseas where oversight is even less strong. This would make the risk the government raises even more likely, not less. Third, there are ways to solve for risk of some gain-of-function research without a full ban. This House could limit funding to certain types of gain-of-function research, or ban research into particularly dangerous pathogens, or increase research and funding around biosafety laboratories and procedures. In conclusion, the government's position is far too radical to take seriously. Even if we believe there are dangers to gain-of-function research, those dangers can be adequately mitigated through measures besides a ban. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. It's an honor to be here. My name is John Bateman, and I'll be the member of government today. So what I'd like to do in this speech is briefly respond to some of the arguments that we heard from the previous speaker, and then add in one argument of my own. So the first argument that we heard is that a ban would be overbroad, that we could actually continue to have a narrow slice of this research, and we could learn from the benefits of nuclear energy and how well that's been protected. I don't know about you all, but I actually don't find that analogy very reassuring. Nuclear energy is an area where we have literally decades of experience in many, many different types of safety controls. And yet, across those decades, we've had incidents like Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, even in recent memory, the Fukushima attack, the Fukushima incident, and the possibility of another incident in Ukraine. Now, if there were another nuclear disaster that could kill or harm thousands of people in the immediate area, but a pathogen, if it had some kind of breakthrough pandemic possibility, it could potentially kill millions. We've already seen that with COVID, so I don't find that very reassuring. The next argument is about how it's critical to have these gain-of-function research pathogens for science. But what we never heard from the Prime Minister is, if it's so critical, how does he explain the fact that this is actually just a small slice of research to combat pathogens? Very small slice. And for decades, we've done very well without this research. So I don't think we've ever heard a true argument that this is critical. At most, I think he could say this is moderately beneficial, but even that really is somewhat speculative. And I think even the example that he used, I think the Prime Minister admitted, is kind of on the border of whether it's even gain-of-function research. The third argument that we heard is that we could always limit this short of an outright ban. We could have better regulation and have a narrower amount of gain-of-function research than we do today. And he gave the example of, well, for example, we couldn't maybe restrict gain-of-function research on the most dangerous pathogens. Well, if that's the path that we take, it's then hard to understand the tremendous benefits that we're told that this gain-of-function research would have. If we're never going to use it on the most dangerous pathogens, the ones that we're really worried about, then what is really the point of all of this research? So with those responses out of the way, I want to make one additional point that we haven't talked about yet. Why did COVID kill so many people? Why did over 1 million Americans die of COVID and many more around the world? Well, you could say it had to do with the attributes of the virus. You could say it had to do with the deadliness, the transmissibility. But I think something that we don't talk about enough is the factor of trust. Societal trust in our public health institutions and our major governmental authorities. It's very frayed and it's very damaged by some of the mistakes that were made in COVID, and by some of the erosion of trust more generally. And I think now is actually a rather dangerous time to say that as the US government, we're gonna continue to support research that many people legitimately feel is very dangerous, suspect, and has unclear cost benefits. I think that could actually further erode trust in the public health system and potentially lead to many more losses of life in the here and now. And the worst case scenario, the absolute worst case, is if there were gain of function research that resulted in a virulent pathogen that did actually escape and it came to light that we had an opportunity to prevent that and we didn't. That could absolutely shatter society's trust in governmental public health authorities and leave us largely defenseless against that pandemic. With that, I rest my case.
Absence of the board member, it now calls the member opposition to order the final constructive speech of the round, not to exceed 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and most of this House for allowing us to oppose this motion. I'd like to start by responding to the points made by the member of government and then talk about the new point that he raised in erosion of public trust and why we shouldn't allow conspiracy theories about eroding public trust limit and harm scientific research. So the member of government first started by saying that you can't conduct gain-of-function research in safe ways, and he talked about the dangers of nuclear energy research. But I think that his points actually prove the opposite, because we have shown, and the Labor opposition showed, that the government still conducts and still allows researchers to conduct research into dangerous aspects of science, research into the smallpox virus, research into the polio virus, and research into nuclear energy. And no one here today has said that the government should stop investigating smallpox at all, in which in fact, people recognize that research into smallpox has helped us combat the current monkeypox epidemic spreading today. No one here today has said we must cut off all nuclear energy research. In fact, people in Germany, even people in Japan, are rethinking their opposition to nuclear energy in the face of climate change and energy risks from Russia's invasion of Ukraine. So I think we can conduct even sensitive biological research in controlled settings, in secure settings, if we regulate it correctly, the same way we've done it with smallpox, and the same way we've done it with gain of research for the past decade. Now, they've talked about the risks of gain of function research and the harms of gain of function research. And we heard earlier that gain of function research started a decade ago with H5N1. And in fact, those studies publishing the entire genome sequence of the modified H5N1 virus, the virus that they say is so transmissible and so dangerous, nothing came of it. It allowed us to expand our scientific knowledge, but it didn't cause some lab leak. It didn't cause some pandemic. And so for the decade since, we've safely conducted gain-of-function research, learning about science and learning about viruses in a safe way that there's no reason to stop today. The second thing that that the members of government has argued is that gain-of-function research has no value. And that's simply not the case. The Leader of Opposition has given you concrete examples of therapies that were developed with gain-of-function research. And gain-of-function research is even more important once we realize that pandemics are rapidly mutating. And that yesterday's viruses, last winter's Omicron virus, needs to be combated by predicting future viruses, not by merely putting band-aids on a problem and letting viruses replicate and mutate faster than we can actually combat them. Gain-of-function research is absolutely valuable, and it has already shown it's valuable in vaccines and therapies. The last thing the member of government has talked about with this new argument is the erosion in public health. But he hasn't connected any erosion in public health due to the COVID pandemic with gain-of-function research. The COVID pandemic was not caused by gain-of-function research, and letting conspiracy theorists basically malign gain-of-function research and the scientists who are conducting valuable studies to advance vaccine technology is allowing fear-mongering to stifle and chill scientific research. We need scientific research to combat tomorrow's viruses, to combat tomorrow's bacterial infections, and without gain-of-function research, we're simply tying our hands. Thank you very much.
So now it's time for 4 speeches from the audience. Does anyone have a speech for the government side in favor of banning gain-of-function? What about opposite? opposition? If no one's, and does anyone want to give a cross bench or something? That's next time you have to ask people ahead of time to do this struggle. Does anyone want to give a cross bench? We'll try this better the next time we do these. All right. So with that, we'll do closing statements from the two sides, and so the government team gets the last word. So call on the leader of opposition to deliver the closing statement for the opposition and the speech after C 3 minutes. Here.
All right, so I'm gonna start real quick by breaking down what's gone on in the round so far. The central issue at hand is whether or not gain-of-function research is currently practiced in the United States today. Provides more benefit than potential risk or negative outcome. And that was the central point of the government's case. So we had heard first that there was the potential benefits were speculative, and the government, however, failed to adequately respond to the examples that were brought up in our first opposition speech. We brought an example of a leukemia drug that was created, venetoclax, that was licensed in Australia based on gain-of-function research in bacteria, followed by other microorganisms, where successive expressions of a protein showed that there was oncogenic potential in that gene, and then targeting that gene in future therapies was an effective leukemia, an effective counter leukemia. We also showed that there are. We also mentioned the way that we need diseases to be localized or to be passaged through animals to provide animal models for future research of diseases that don't require, for instance, human challenge studies. Those things are really important and not very speculative gains of scientific research, but scientific research at the end of the day is a very incremental and baseline process. And so if we blanket cut out one entire tool in the scientific research arsenal, that only does us harm in the long run. And it's impossible to predict what specifically might be the issue there, but it's something that we need to worry about. So what it comes down to, it should also be noted that the definition, the overbroadness argument we made in our first and second speeches are really important to keep in mind here. So if we do a full ban on gain-of-function research, we mentioned in our first speech that the definition of gain-of-function research offered by the government, namely one that just simply increases the pathogenicity of a virus or a microorganism, is far too narrow. And even if it's not too narrow, the ongoing discussions and debates today about in media about gain-of-function research show that it is a very, very fuzzy concept. And so there's a very large potential for a chilling effect, where even if we think that there is some need to regulate some of it, to shamelessly suck up to one of the judges sitting in the audience who writes a lot about indie issues, Jerusalem Dences, these well-meaning sort of regulations can pile up and end up doing more harm than good because of their chilling effect on otherwise important research. So ultimately, it comes down to, do we think that there is a potential for benefit? And even if you don't buy the analogy to like smallpox or nuclear energy, that potential has still been demonstrated in the therapeutics that we mentioned and that were not adequately responded to by the government. And vaccines and adenovirus vaccines, we have modified adenovirus to create functionally new organisms or organisms with new traits, and that can be considered in many ways a form of gain of function. And the only that leaves the only offensive argument coming from the government side as one of public trust. But that argument is not particularly unique because the crisis of public trust in public health is not something that has to do with gain-of-function research. The fact that people don't believe in vaccines does not believe that vaccines themselves are something that we need to completely end research in. So on the balance, what we've only been told over and over again is that there is a risk for a pandemic via gain-of-function research. But we've also stressed throughout this that there are other solvency mechanisms besides a complete and total ban that could capture some of the benefits from the argument from the government. For instance, we could go back to the moratorium on the high pandemic pathogen potential research. And yes, we do think that research is important. But the burden on the government is to prove why, even absent that research, why all forms of gain-of-function research into less pandemic potential viruses and microorganisms are important. It's for those reasons that we oppose the measure to ban gain-of-function research in the United States.
Opposition and calls on the leader for government to go to the speech of the rounds.
So I'll begin by saying, as a debater, I think that both sides came out very strong. I think the government, the prime minister, was very confident, very strong in speech. So I had captivated. I think where I lost it with the government was the other two speakers, and so I sort of went to the opposition because the opposition came in. And what I was looking for was, this is why we shouldn't do it, and this is what we should do instead. And I got got that from the opposition. I kind of got, this is why we should continue doing it, and this is the reason why, and this is point, 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 point. And so my vote will go to the opposition.
I like both parties of the debate, I'm looking at when the government find Dan Fonson, and then obviously Clovey Hogman and the government's definition being overruled and the reasons why. I'm going to go with the government because of the fact that the risk, the argument they made that the risk outweighed the reward, and how the opposition didn't say how beneficial this would be in the risk reward situation where, okay, risk outweighing reward, and he made the case as to why.
I think he did excellent jobs, brought up some really valid points. I thought both teams did a great job responding to a number of the arguments. I am going to go in favor of the opposition because I felt that they stayed true to their point and kept them going through each of the speakers. While addressing the government's positions, they did continue to provide examples of why gain of function would be important to continue supporting. Where the government, I felt like, had an opening where there were lots of statements about where there were opportunities outside of gain of function to continue getting great results and getting good research, but I didn't hear examples for that. And that's where I kind of ended up leaning with the opposition, but I thought Philippines did an excellent job.
I agree that both teams did a great job. I think each team raised some points that were not effectively rebutted by the other side, which makes it hard in terms of scoring to decide where to come down. I thought that especially the government's argument that that the number of changes you can observe in these lab experiments is small relative to the tremendous diversity that occurs in the environment, so that the benefits are pretty speculative. I thought that had some salience, but I thought that was actually rebutted reasonably well by saying, yeah, but there are these things that have been studied and that have passages and gain of function resulted in benefits. So, but I thought that the complexity argument was not well rebutted. And the regrets were saying that, well, there, you know, if you have an accident, and accidents happen, and we've seen accidents, but the accidents can be limited in scope with a nuclear accident, let's say, I think the rebut versus relative to a reasonably some global pandemic, was interesting. I think that the really creative argument by the opposition was basically saying, you're going too broad, you're going to chill research, and that's really going to limit our, and that is in itself a big risk. And so on the end, I come down, I think, on the side of the opposition.
Yeah, I think it was a really great round. I think one thing that would have made it definitely easier as a judge would have been for folks to drawing out their impacts a bit more, interacting with each other's side, but it was really great. I did this recently, and everyone's speech was much better than I was able to. So I ended up going with OP, and I started there because basically there's kind of an unresponded point from OP that the ban would move it to other countries, meaning that many of the risks are still going to exist even if you do ban it. There's a kind of a point that Gov brings up that sort of interacts with this, which is that the U.S. can influence a lot of other countries. But it's not really, I mean, clearly there's still opportunity there, so you still have this risk of pandemic there. But I also think that OP sufficiently gets a lot of the government's ground by pointing out the fact that while you clearly can do safety regulations, given that a lot of the gain of function research that's going on right now hasn't resulted in these large pandemics and these risks that we're talking about here, that even though there are these clear examples of six vials or whatever that are left out, this has not resulted in something really harmful. So. And then I think that the consent argument that comes out in the last speech, I think is a good point, but I think it's sufficiently pre-butted essentially by opposition's points about how there are lots of dangerous things that no one that's around is actually contesting continuing to exist, which a lot of people don't consent to, and that are clearly good, whether it's investigating smallpox in order to prevent monkeypox, or whether it's nuclear, which I think is actually a really good example for op, because we are actually seeing a lot of these countries reevaluate the value of nuclear energy given the Russian energy crisis and things like this. So I end up going with op.
So I really struggled because I thought everyone is excellent, obviously, and everyone had great examples. I really struggled because of the resolution. And the resolution was ban research. And you both had different definitions of what that entailed. And if I were to judge the round based on Gov's definition, I would have gone with Gov. But because the resolution was ban it, and I thought that there was a good debate over the meaning, then there was these alternatives that Opt had brought up that didn't seem inconsistent with the resolution. I went with that. And there was a couple of like examples that, you know, if under that rubric and not just the, like, I did think that there was a very effective argument here on like, the next pandemic and the not, you know, the government will completely shut down, you're gonna lose all the trust. Like, I thought that was like incredibly persuasive, but just this idea of an alternative and maybe even like a moratorium or less risky kind of brought me towards that.
I went kind of on the other end of what I think I fundamentally believe, which is really interesting. And I think I more sided with Gov because of the fact that I thought that the execution of the argument, I think I preferred in terms of like having very clear thought kind of laid out, even though I think, again, my own personal bias is kind of leaning towards up, and I think there were a lot of really strong arguments that I fundamentally agree with, but I thought that, you know, I thought the speakers had kind of laid things out in a way that, you know, were a little bit more persuasive, slash, I think they really leaned on the fear-based tendencies we have post-pandemic in a really amazing way during the arguments. I think the like statement of like all it takes is one in the closing, and like really leaning on this like, you know, like, what are the benefits really? And I think you guys ended that really well. So I
agree with all the points everybody's made on both sides. Both sides did an excellent job. I thought the opposition had a stronger start, but in the end, I leaned very, very slightly toward the government side for many of the same reasons from the others have raised. But the opposition, through the later part of the debate, I think just did not as effectively rebut the point of even if there is value to this type of research, it's not critical to do compared to other methods and things like that. Which is a different bar, but that's part of government's role in society is figuring out where those types of lines should be drawn and things like that. So while the opposition definitely demonstrated that there could be value for this type of research, didn't quite get to the point of enough of it to kind of move that far because it is a really remarkable way for us.
I thought everybody did such an amazing, this is my first experience seeing a debate, so I was really, I feel like my training has, this is a clear deficit, and just being able to examine an issue this way is really fascinating, and I really thought both teams did a great job of illuminating some of the complexities of this issue. So I do know more about the subject matter than the process, and I illuminated a lot of the complexities that people are really struggling with right now. I think I see the point about the criticality of the research. I think my bias in being able to doing research and not knowing what's going to happen next, you know, and just being surprised, usually surprised because things don't work the way that you expect them to, I placed less emphasis on the criticality of it because I think that's very difficult to predict. So in that that case, I thought that the examples, the many examples of the opposition raised were very compelling. And so I appreciate the whole process, I will vote the opposition.
So likewise, first time experience for me as well. And I also would have to say that, you know, during our deliberations, it was great to hear how we're all making different decisions based on what everybody thought was done well. And so for me, I think my decision goes kind of back to the very beginning, hearing about the cost benefits analysis. So I felt like the costs were very clearly defined, but weren't necessarily rebutted as well. And then also from the benefits standpoint, I think, you know, the example of the leukemia drug, right, was right there, but that's not necessarily translated to lives saved. With that was kind of like really what was kind of stuck on my mind. So I'm gonna go with government.
Great. So the floor vote was actually 50-50 between government and opposition. So the opposition got, by my count, I think two more votes from the judges. So the opposition wins the debate. Great job, everyone. Thanks so much.